static force analysis. So what is a force? An interaction that causes an effect, the object to push or to be pulled, right? So which means an external member which causes the affected object to be pushed or pulled in a certain direction. So if we have an object, right, say for example I have an object, okay, it's too thick, right, and if I am applying certain force in this direction, so what will happen is it would be moving on this direction, right? So this is the pushed interaction that causes an affected object. So in this object we are applying the force, so that interaction which causes the affected object to be pushed or pulled. So if I apply this way, it is being pushed. If I apply the force this way, it is pulled, right? So this is pulled. So this is what called the forces, right? The affected body should move, either it should be pulled or it should be pushed, right? So this is what the force meant. Then we have the static force, right? If the components of a machine accelerate, inertia forces are produced due to their masses, right? So if it is a machine, then it definitely have some moving mass, right? So whatever the machine you take, right, it will have some moving mass, right? Maybe moving up and down or sideways or rotating, right? So it will have some mass. However, if the magnitude of these forces are small compared to the externally applied load, they can be neglected while analyzing the mechanism. Then I have constraint of force. So we keep an object in the table, right? So this is a table, we keep an object, right? So the mass due to gravity, you know, will act downwards, while the normal force will act upwards, right? So this is upward. So usually normal force would be equal to weight, right? Otherwise what will happen? If either mass or gravity by mass is great, then this should break the table and go below that. If this force is high, then what will happen? This object would be standing on the air, right? So to prevent these two, usually this normal force will be equal to the mass due to gravity. We call it as weight, right? So a pair of action and reaction forces which constrain two connected bodies, right? So two connected bodies, one body is the object and one body is the table, right? To behave in a particular manner depending upon the nature of connection, right? Behave in a particular manner, right? So if you see here, the normal force is equal to the weight of mass due to gravity, right? They occur in pairs, they have no net force on the system of bodies. So there is no net force. So net force is, if you add all the forces, what do you obtain will be the net force, right? So net force is something. So if I add this normal force, right? So I will apply force equation in this direction. So here in this direction, I have normal force. So I will write normal force. So since I am taking upwards, normal force is also acting upwards. So that is plus. And then I have the mass due to gravity, right? So that would be acting downwards, but I'm taking upwards. So that will come in minus. Minus mg, right? So mg mass into gravity, that is weight. And there are no any other forces in the system. So which will be equal to zero, right? So this equation will give you normal force nf equal to mg. So there are no net force here because the resultant force is zero, right? The resultant force is, so here is our resultant force, that is zero. So there is no net force, right? So can you tell me What is the situation if this object it kept in a slant, right, in a slippery path, but it is not moving? So it is not moving either this way or this way, which means it is in a state of equilibrium, so there is no net force. Can somebody tell me what would be the equation? So if you write the equation like this, so here I write all the forces to make it to zero, right? So in this case, how can we write the equation of forces to make this system zero, right? Here we have an object, it has a mass. So mass, we know, should appear directly downwards toward the gravity, right? So here is our weight, that is mg, right? And we have a normal force, right? So this is our normal force, which should appear perpendicular to the plane, right? So if this is the plane, it should appear perpendicular to the plane. If this is the plane, then it should appear perpendicular to the plane, right? So here we have only these two forces, and also we have one more force, which is the frictional force, which is acting upwards. Why friction force acting upwards? Otherwise the body would be moving downwards now. So if it is not moving downwards, right, so this way it should move. So if it is not moving downwards, which means it has some force acting upwards, right? So that is our frictional force, right? That's our frictional force. So now we have this body three forces, right? One force is our normal force, one force is the mg, that is mass due to gravity, weight, and one force is the frictional force. So I am now going to make these forces to act in the opposite direction. So if you see here, the normal force is acting this way, the mass is acting this way, so they are opposite in direction, right? Similar way I will solve here also. So here I have normal force which is acting in this way, this is normal force, and our friction is acting this way, and mg is acting this way, right? So now I have to solve this to act in only two directions. So what I will do, I will keep this frictional force and normal force as it is, but I will divide the mg as into two components, right? So mg, if I divide into two components, I will have one mg here and one mg here, right? So if this is theta, right, if this angle is theta, then this angle is 90, this angle is 90 minus theta, right? Okay, so if this is 90 minus theta, then this would be theta, right? This would be theta. So when we divide this mg into this component and this component, this is theta, which means this is mg cos theta, mg cos theta, and this way it is mg sine theta. So when we divide this force into these two directions, right, so first I will take into this direction, right? So there we have one normal acting this way and one mg cos theta acting this way, right? So they are opposite in direction, right? So that part is fine. And when I take this way, right, which is perpendicular to the direction which I take again, so this way I have the frictional force, right, and this way I have mg cos theta, right? So unless and until these two conditions are fulfilled, we don't have to, I mean, the object will not move, right? If n is equal to mg cos theta and f is equal to mg sine theta, this object will not move. It would be staying steadily. So this f is actually mu into normal force, right? Mu into normal force. So that mu, we call it as coefficient of friction, right? So this coefficient of friction, when you increase this theta angle, so little by little, so if you make this slant going this way, right, and if I have the angle something like this, then at that stage, this will start moving downwards, right? So this is a theta dependent, right? Theta dependent. When you increase the theta, at a particular stage, this will start moving downwards, right? Until then, it will not move. So in the equilibrium stage, the F, which is mu n cos theta, is equal to mg sin theta, right? In this case, there will not be any movement, right? There will not be any movement. So this object will keep on staying steady, right? So if you see, they occur in pairs. They have net force. They have no net force in the system of body. So occur in pairs. So which means pair is two, right? So here in this direction, there is a normal force and there is a component of mg. So mg cos theta. So that is a pair. We have two force. Here in this direction, I have mg sin theta and frictional force. So there are two forces. They are acting in a pair, right? So there are two forces, right? So they are acting in a pair, and net force, they have no net force. So if you see, they are equal, so which means it is zero. So there is no net force, right? So this is how the constraint of force would act, right? So there won't be any motion if the net force is zero. Force acting from outside on a system of bodies, right? So what you have seen in the previous diagram, there were no any external forces, right? There were no any external forces. Just we keep the object in a slant. Due to that particular incident, there are forces generated automatically, right? The normal, the mg, frictional force, they all are generated automatically. We never applied any external force. Here in the diagram which we are seeing now, we are applying a force, right? An external force. So applied force, force acting from outside on a system of bodies. They are applied through direct physical or mechanical contact, right? So physical contact is what you are seeing in the screen now, right? So a person is pushing an object in a slant, right? Force like electrical, magnetic and gravitational are applied without actual physical contact. So there are any other forces like electric force, magnetic force, gravitational force, right? There are different types of forces which they don't need a physical contact, right? They automatically form force without a physical contact, or gravitational force. So if a coconut is in the coconut tree, it will fall automatically down towards the ground. It never need a force, physical force to act on it so that it will come to ground. It will automatically come to ground. So it is a force without a physical contact, right? So applied force can be with the physical contact or without physical contact. So here we have a mechanical contact also. In a forward mechanism, we apply a force, right, for a particular bar, right? So if I have this as a bar, right, so this we will say ground, right? So this is our mechanism, right? So here is a joint, here is a joint, here is a joint, and here is a joint. So when you apply a force to this member, right, when you apply a force to this member, we are applying a physical force to this member. So this member should move. That is obvious, right? This member should move. But when this member is moving, this member and this member also moving, right? This member and this member are also moving, but we didn't apply any physical force on that. We apply physical force only in this member. So why these two links are moving is because the mechanical contact, right? So this, this and this, this are connected in a joint, through a joint. So there is a mechanical contact. So if you apply a physical force on this member, this link and this link will move due to the mechanical contact, right? So in this sense, right? This is a general question. So this guy is applying some force. So assume that this object is moving upwards, right? Assume that this object is moving upwards. What are the forces acting on this body? So now I have the normal force, the gravitational force, and the frictional force. I have applied all three forces. No, not three, four forces. Here I have a force also, right? The external force which is applied by the man. So static equilibrium remains in its state of rest or motion. So we know, right? First law of motion. If a body is in rest, it will keep on rest. Otherwise, it will be keep on moving unless, right? So if the body is at rest, it tends to remain at rest. So if there is a static equilibrium, then if I keep an object somewhere, then it will stay in that rest position without moving anywhere. So if I keep a box in the table, right? So if there is no any external forces, then this box will keep on staying in this table, right? So upwards we have N, downwards we have an mg. So they are not external forces. So if you are not applying any force, it will keep on staying steady, right? If the body is in the motion, it tends to keep the motion, right? So velocity but is coming back there, right? So if a body is moving with a constant velocity, then that will be move with that constant velocity, right? So if there are no any external forces acting, so in that case you should remember air resistance is also an external force, right? So say for example you roll a ball, right, maybe in a ground. So according to your expectation, that should move without any interruption. But if you see in the practical, that will stay in a certain distance, right? So if I have this as a ground, if I roll a ball in this direction, if there are no external forces, that should keep on moving. But in your practical experience, you would get to know in certain stage that would stop. So first thing, we have the friction force this reacting, and so we have the air resistance also, right? So we have air resistance as well as the frictional force. So this is why the ball stop while rolling, right? So if the body is in motion, it tends to keep on motion if there are no any external forces acting. So this air resistance is one external force, friction is another external force, then this will not be applied, right? So in static equilibrium, right, so this is a condition. Now we are going to see the vector sum of all the forces acting on the body is zero, right? So if you remember the previous two slide slant cases, I told you if I use the equal sign, then there is no motion. So if the vector sum of all the forces are zero, then there is no any motion. So that is this condition, right? Vector sum of all the forces, right? So all the forces, sigma is for the sum, equal to zero, then there is no motion, right? In this case, there is no motion. Vector sum of all the moments about any arbitrary point is zero, right? So any arbitrary point, so we take moment taking any arbitrary point. So if I take moment about this point or this point or this point, right, if you take moment of any arbitrary point, the force is zero, sorry, the moment should be zero, then the body will be in the static equilibrium. So this T we denote for moment, right, moment of forces, and sigma is for the vector sum, it should be zero, right? So if these two conditions are fulfilled, then only a body will be in a static equilibrium, right? So equilibrium of two force members. So there can be two force members, there can be three force members, there can be n number of force members, but what we do, we reduce it to either two or three force member in order to solve any sum or equation, right? So in such case, say for example, this is a body, right? This is a body. We have two points A and B, right? Two points A and B. So the force F1 is acting in the point A, and force F2 is acting on the point B, okay? For the equilibrium, so if the object now need to be in the equilibrium, what are the conditions, right? If the body need to be in the equilibrium. So according to what we see, the forces should be equal to zero, right? Net forces should be equal to zero. So which means sigma F equal to zero. So if I apply this condition, right? So I will take this direction, okay? This direction we have force now. So I will take this direction. So I will take this direction here also. There I have F1. I have another force F2, but that is acting exactly opposite to the direction of F1. So I would put minus F2. So if the body is to be in equilibrium, then the resultant of these two forces must be zero, right? So F1 minus F2 should be zero. So if I solve this one, I will have F1 is equal to F2, right? F1 is equal to F2, right? So our condition, sigma F is equal to zero, it is fulfilled, right? Then I have sigma T is equal to zero. T is our moment about any arbitrary axis. So in order to solve the equation easily and quickly, right, we particularly take a point, right, where the maximum number of forces are passing through that, right, where the maximum number of forces are passing through that. So if I take this point, right, so here I mark a point C, right, here I mark a point C. If I am going to take moment about this point C, right, how many forces are passing through this point C? No any force, right, because both the forces are passing in through this direction, so there are no forces passing through this. So if I take moment about this point C, can I do the, I mean, can I solve the equation or not? I can solve. So if you see the line of action, right, line of action. So if the F2 force I draw, this is going all the way like this, right? And F1 force, that is also going all the way like this, right? So this is the line of action, right? So I can draw a perpendicular from this C to this line, right? So you already know that moment is equal to force into perpendicular distance from the point to that force, right? Distance perpendicular, right? So perpendicular distance from the point to that force line of action, right? So if I take this as D, right, this distance from this C point to this perpendicular point as the D, and force I have F and F, right, F1 and F2. So I will write two equations. What's the matter? So now I will write that also I am going to take in the clockwise direction, okay? So you should know momentum should be shown either in clockwise direction or anti-clockwise direction. Like force you are showing either horizontal or vertical or in some direction, moment also you need to show whether it is clockwise direction or anti-clockwise direction. So now I am taking clockwise direction. So from C point to this point, right, force I have F1, I am talking only for F1 now, right? So F1 is acting in a clockwise direction, right, into distance D, right, into distance D. So this is the moment. I have another force F2, but that is acting this way, right? F2 is acting this way, so that is actually anti-clockwise, but I am taking moment only on clockwise direction, so I should put minus, right? I should put minus. then F2 into length between the force or line of action of force and the point where I am taking momentum from is D, right? So these are the only two forces, F1 and F2. These are the only two forces. So I write only those two forces. Then there will be zero. So if I solve this, F1 into D will be equal to F2 into D, right? So if I remove D from both two parts, F1 will be equal to F2. So that's what I have now, right? So this is the conclusion from momentum diagram also. So now my question is, then if I can solve, even if I take a point somewhere here, then why I am taking a point in this line, AB line, in order to solve it? So if I take any point on this line, then this distance will be zero, right? So if this distance is zero, then you don't need to write any equation, right? By this equation, you simply say both the forces are acting on the same line of action. So there will be, you don't need to write any equation. So that is actually easy, right? So only for the purpose of easiness and quickness, we are taking a point which is on that line of action of forces. Maximum forces, if they pass through one line, maximum forces, if they pass through a point, then we will take that point as the reference point, that momentum, because for several forces, we will have the distance would be zero, right? So this is the reason why we take a point which is actually a large number of forces passing through. It does not mean that if you take any other arbitrary point, you can't solve. It does not mean that, right? Because what is our theory saying? Our theory is saying the momentum from any arbitrary point should be zero if the object need to be in the static equilibrium, right? So theory is allowing us to take the momentum from any number of arbitrary point. It is not saying that you need to take the momentum from a particular point, right? So wherever you can take, you can solve the equation. It can either be somewhere here, or point D, right? Somewhere here, or point E, right? So anywhere you can take and solve. What would happen if I take a point somewhere here outside the object? I would say that point as Z. So this is two force body. Then I have three force body. What will happen if the point is not perpendicular? Yeah, the point need not to be perpendicular. So if it is not perpendicular, you just make it perpendicular. So for example, if I am taking some, where do you want me to take? So shall I take here? Right, so I will take that point as Z, right? So if that point is not perpendicular, what you do, you draw a line perpendicular to that and make it perpendicular. Because this force is not going to be perpendicular all the time. You have to make it perpendicular. Because if you take F1, then this line is perpendicular to F1 force. You see here. So this F2, that also perpendicular to this one, right? If it is outside the line. So this point is outside the line now. Even if it is outside the line, you just make it perpendicular. So you are not going to prepare anything which can be visual. These all are like imaginary lines, right? So don't confuse with that. So this line is an imaginary line, right? So whether you are taking action about this point or this point or this point, right? So only this force is the real thing. The line you are drawing from here to here is also perpendicular. From here to here is also perpendicular. Here to here is also perpendicular, right? So these all are imaginary lines, right? And here to here also perpendicular. That's also imaginary lines. So wherever you want to take, right, somewhere here also you can take, right? So you make this force going that way, and this is our perpendicular, right? So it is perpendicular to F2, it is perpendicular to F1, right? So if I take this point, that is Y, right? So this point need not to be inside the object, right?